Hey guys, Brett Weiss here. Welcome to another Tales from a Retro Rocker. We are flashing back to the 1986 Texas Jam. This was an insane show, and I got mixed up a little bit with a cop and this guy that would not budge out of my seat, but I'll get to that in a little bit. So the 1986 Texas Jam was an amazing show that featured just a terrific lineup. Bachman Turner Overdrive, the late great Ronnie James Dio, Keel, Crocus, Loverboy, and Van Halen was the headlining act. Now, the Texas Jam began in 1978, and it went through 1988. There were shows in Houston, but the ones I went to were in Dallas, Texas, at the Cotton Bowl. Thousands and thousands of people would just jam into the Cotton Bowl for these one-day massive festivals out in the hot Texas sun. And we would just absolutely boil, but it was so much fun. There were so many crazy things going on. I went to a bunch of Texas Jams in the 80s, and there were topless girls there. I remember in 83, Ozzy was there, just amazing, dumping buckets of water on the first few rows, and their set just killed it. 38 Special followed them and just absolutely died, because you just cannot follow Ozzy if you're 38 Special. I remember one guy next to me at a Texas Jam, he was sitting there having a hot dog and a Coke, as one does at an event, and he pulls out a bag of mushrooms and just sprinkles them across the mushroom, across the hot dog, and eats it. And these were not the kind of mushrooms your mom puts in spaghetti. They were of the psychedelic variety. I remember Grim Reaper was there, this band, and they close out with, "See you in hell, Dallas!" And everybody booed, because this is Dallas, the Bible Belt, a very religious town. And I remember one time we saw Poison at the Texas Jam, and Paul Stanley came out and did Strutter with Poison. This was absolutely unexpected, a complete surprise. It was amazing. So many great memories of the Texas Jam. But I have a couple of not so pleasant memories about the 86 Jam. These bands were great, but I got into a little bit of, I didn't get arrested or anything, but I did have some, you know, just a couple of bummers. So here's what happened. So me and three friends went. And the way the admission worked was, you could buy, you know, a couple of different kinds of tickets. You could get general admission, which was down on the football field, where you could go anywhere on the football field. You could get there early and jam up near the front and just try to get good seats all day. Or you could just kind of hang around in the back. But the football field, there's a lot of cool stuff going on there. People were bouncing beach balls around. There were just crazy people everywhere. I remember one guy just cutting through everybody, just knocking people over, talking about how effed up he was, and just, you just see all these crazy people, these hippie, you know, older hippies, these young metalheads, all kinds of crazy people thrown together. It's a wonder we all lived through the Texas Jams to tell about it. So in 1986, I was 19 years old, and I was with three other guys at this concert, you know, just four teenagers, and we had hung out on the football field a while, you know, we're having a blast, but at some point we got tired. We did have reserve seating. Now, reserve seats were in the bleachers, and we did have, and they were a little more expensive, but we started off on the football field because that's where, you know, all the action was and you're hanging out and having fun. But once we got tired and we wanted something to eat, we wanted to sit down for a while, we left the football field and went up to our seats, which were in the bleachers, four seats. Well, when we got up there, there was this big guy. He was about 6'5". He had arms as big as tree trunks, and he's there with his girlfriend, and they're in two of our four seats. And we're like, "Excuse me, sir. Those are our seats. We have, you know, reserved seating." And we showed him the number on the seats, the number on our tickets. And he said he had general admission and he could sit anywhere. And so we explained to him that, no, you can't sit anywhere. You can only be on the football field. Well, he didn't listen to our reason, our logic. He probably knew that he was in the wrong, but he didn't care. He was sitting there. He was big. We were just a bunch of punk kids. He wasn't going to budge. And there was absolutely nothing, you know, just four skinny teenage punks could do about it with this big dude that could have broken us in half just by looking at us. And so what to do? Big Mike was not with us. Now, Big Mike, very briefly, he was this guy that went with us to a lot of concerts. He was my friend Bill's dad. And he was a cool dad that would hang out with us, that would go, you know, to concerts with us, that would go out to eat with us, that would just kind of hang out at the apartments with us. And he was a cool guy. You know, he's this old hippie. He was a self-help guru. He was into like mysticism and pyramid power. He was a rocker. Really interesting guy to hang out with. And unfortunately, he was not with us. He was a big, imposing guy with long hair. And he always wore this pink Harry's Hot Rod t-shirt. And he was a nice guy. He was cool. He was laid back. But you did not want to cross him. You did not want to make him mad. And he protected us. You know, we went to a lot of, you know, bars and all these crazy places, you know, and, you know, kind of seedy parts of town. And we were going to all these concerts. And when Mike was with us, we had not a care in the world because he was basically our bodyguard. But he was not with us. For some reason, he didn't go with us to this particular Texas jam. And oh, how we wish he would have been there, because he would have stepped in and absolutely told that guy to move. And that guy would have moved because Mike was very imposing. Mike was tough, and you just did not mess with Mike. He would have handled the situation. But there we were. We really wanted our seats. We were hot. We were tired. We had paid good money for these seats. So what do? I go up to tell a police officer because, you know, what else? That's the only way we could perhaps get this guy to leave. And it is just burning hot. It is packed. There are people, you know, the stairs leading up to the concession stands and the commons area where I would look for a police officer. Once I finally got up these stairs, which were just jam-packed, I went up to this, you know, kind of near the concession stands and restrooms and everything, and I found a police officer. This rather rotund individual he looked so stressed out, and he was just sweating. I'm not gonna say sweating like a pig, for obvious reasons. He was just sweating very heavily. And he didn't look too approachable, but I wanted our seats, dadgummit. And so I went up to him and I tried to explain the situation to him. I said, hey, there's a guy down there that has our seats. We have reserved seating and he will not move. Well, he looked at me, he scowled at me, and he's just got sweat pouring out of his face. He looks stressed because there are too few cops at this place, way too many people crammed into this football stadium. And he looked so stressed, and he blew up at me. He told me if I didn't get away from him, if I didn't get out of his face, which I wasn't in his face, I was just approaching him normally. He said, if I didn't get away and shut up and go away, he was gonna, I don't remember what he said, but something to the effect he was gonna arrest me or kick my ass or something. But he was super pissed, and he had such, I could tell, he was on the verge. He was so stressed from just all these people around me. And who knows, by this point in the day, it was late in the afternoon, no telling what he had put up with to that point. He'd probably, I mean, who knows? He might have broken up some fights or just had constantly people asking him where to go or just getting on him for one thing or another, needing things. And he was, because he just looked super pissed off and stressed, and he just blew up in my face and just told me to go away. He didn't care. And if I said anything else, he would either arrest me or kick my ass. I don't remember which, but he was pissed. And I remember he threatened me. I remember specifically he threatened me. Now, I had one other confrontation with a police officer in Dallas, but I'll do that in another episode. But anyway, so with my tail between my legs, I went back to our seat and we tried to reason with the guy one more time to get out of our seat, and he absolutely would not budge. Well, that's this point, it's getting a little later, and because it took a while I was up there, I got us some food and some, you know, drinks and everything, and worked my way down. It was probably about an hour and a half later until I got back to our seat, because it was just a miserable, you know, when you're 19, you can kind of put up with anything. Now, Texas Jam would make me insane, but back then, I kind of rolled with it. But it was, even then, it was a little, you know, too hot, too stressful, and too crowded. Anyway, I had fun at these Texas Jams, but they were difficult. Sometimes it would take us 3 or 4 hours to get to the jam when it was like an hour from my house. So there were a lot of, you know, problems associated with going to the jam and being there, but it was also a lot of fun and crazy. And so what happened was we, in the general seat, you know, that area where we had our two seats, because this guy and his girlfriend were in two of them, and we had our other two. So my friend Johnny and another guy who I don't remember sat here. Well, I had to sit with that guy that came with us behind him and over to the right a little bit. So we weren't all together where we wanted to be, but we were kind of in the general vicinity. Not ideal, but it still worked out. So we did get to see the show and we did have a great time. But what are you going to do? If someone's bigger than you, more imposing, more threatening, and they can break you in half, and the police won't even help you, you just throw up your hands and you make the best of it. And we did. At least we were sort of in the general vicinity of our other two friends. And we did have a great show. You can't go wrong with Dio, Loverboy, and Van Halen, and BTO. Awesome show. Luckily, I didn't press the cop, because I think if I would have, it could have gotten bad, and maybe who knows what would have happened. And luckily, we weren't stupid enough to you know, keep after this ginormous dude sitting there in our seats. But anyway, just more concert memories, and I will have more in future shows, including the other time I got in a little bit more of a brush with a cop. He actually pulled out his billy club. Not particularly my fault. I mean, I'm a peaceful guy, and I don't, you know, if I get pulled over or whatever, I am like, yes, sir, you know, with my hands on the steering wheel, yes, sir, of course, sir. You know, I'm not a drama guy, and I have a lot of respect for honest and fair police officers. But anyway, with all the crazy concerts I went to, some things were bound to happen. But anyway, I will get to that in another episode. Let me know in the comments, did you ever go to the Texas Jam? Or, you know, did you ever have any crazy confrontations at a concert where someone got your seat or you got hassled by cops or anything like that? Let me know your concert memories in the comments here. And once again, my Encyclopedia of Kiss is available, and you can order copies direct from me. I'll be happy to sign it for you, or you can get them on Amazon. Thank you for watching another Tales from a Retro Rocker. We will talk to you guys in another video. Meanwhile, rock on.